I'm Janie Cohen, curator of the Robert Hull Fleming Museum.
And I'm Michael Oatman, installation artist and faculty member here at the University of Vermont in the art department.
We're taking a tour today of Michael's installation piece entitled Long Shadows, Henry Perkins and the Eugenics Survey of Vermont, which has been on view at the Fleming Museum from September 29th until December 15th.
Long Shadows is what I would describe as a piece of installation art. And to give a brief description, installation art can be thought of as temporary, site-specific artworks which in some way surround the viewer, rather than engaging the viewer in a one-on-one kind of dialogue the way that you would with a discrete piece of artwork like a painting or a sculpture. The artwork in Long Shadows tends to surround the viewer, and you get to move through the space and kind of engage with what you will at whatever time you choose.
So it's more like a theatrical stage set that you can actually enter and explore.
Yeah, I think so. I like to think of Long Shadows as a kind of mixture of a carnival and an office space. It's a place where there are many surprises and a few disturbing things, and I think this is all part of the narrative which involves eugenics, which we'll speak about in a few minutes.
Let's take a look. Before we start talking about the objects in the installation, let's talk a little bit about the subject of it. Henry Perkins was the first director of the Fleming Museum in 1931 and the founder of the Eugenics Survey of Vermont in 1925. You want to tell us a little bit about eugenics and
Sure.
about his role in it?
Eugenics actually was had its origins in Europe. Francis Galton, who was the cousin of Charles Darwin, coined the term eugenics, and essentially eugenics is about improving the human species through selective breeding. This definition later came to include sterilization as an option. And when eugenics arrived in America, it was, I think, received largely as a kind of social science, a kind of pop psychology of breeding. And I think that in its form in the United States, it really took off in a way. And Perkins, who was, as you mentioned, the first director of the Fleming Museum, was simultaneously a zoology professor here at UVM. And in looking for a project for his students to undertake, Perkins wrote the Eugenics Record Office at the Cold Spring Harbor Research Facility in Long Island, and obtained some information from Charles Davenport, who was then the director. And Davenport suggested that he embark on a kind of eugenics survey of the region using some of his students as researchers. So what was initially a kind of school project, university-level project, evolved into an 11-year-long study of various populations in Vermont, and one of the results of this study was the passage of the sterilization law in 1931,
right.
Which coincidentally is the time that the Fleming Museum opened.
That's right. We should also point out that this was not only happening in Vermont. Vermont was one of 33 states that passed sterilization legislation during
That's correct. Period. And I think what's remarkable about the Vermont version of the eugenics survey is that in a state with such a small population, I believe that this survey had a tremendous impact on even present-day populations.
Yeah, that's right.
So,
This project originated with an invitation to Michael to curate an exhibition from the museum's collections. We thought it would be interesting to have a very different perspective on the museum's holdings, to invite an artist, have an artist's eye rather than a curator's eye selecting objects. So we spent a lot of time in the museum storage looking at objects, and you want to focus on a few right now and talk about why you selected them and what role they play in
Sure.
the installation.
This painting right here is called The Hermitage, and it's by Thomas Cole. Well known for his landscape painting. And this is one of the first objects that attracted my eye because I felt that not only was it a very unusual painting, this kind of moody landscape, but I felt that it somehow was a kind of premonition of the imagery which a viewer might encounter moving through this space. It's a kind of foreboding landscape, and there seem to be pockets where something might be secreted, where figures might be hiding. And altogether, kind of a fantastic landscape.
Mm-hmm.
It seems very fabricated in a way.
Mm-hmm. So this is kind of a portent of what's to come as you enter the installation and begin to understand the content of it.
Absolutely, but at the same time, it's also I think an image which establishes a certain level of normalcy. I mean, I'm trying to create a room space here which could be perceived to be inhabitable by a professor, a scientist, a person of some means. And I think that a painting like this is a real description of that kind of economic position. Yeah.
Tell me about the wallpaper.
Sure. The wallpaper is actually an outgrowth of an image that I found in the Fleming's permanent collection. And if you want to come over here, Janie, there's an image, a silhouette portrait of Thomas Chittenden, which I found in the permanent collection. And the silhouette got me thinking about specifically the human head and how this is the seat of knowledge, it's the seat of the emotions, and how the portrait over the years has really come to sort of embody what we think of a person, whether or not we know anything about them. It seems to be the nature of the portrait which is the most revealing. Yeah. And so that got me off and running on the idea of silhouettes. And so I did some research, and the silhouettes that you see on this wall are profiles of what were termed in this book noble Europeans and Americans. There's a silhouette of George Washington, a silhouette of Walt Whitman, even a silhouette of Francis Galton, who, as I mentioned earlier, was the coiner of the term eugenics. And I wanted to set these off in gold because gold was, gold and green are the University of Vermont colors. And so, again, referring back to the idea of the silhouette, this really became an important motif for the piece, the idea of the human head. And on this table as well, there are a number of small figurines and body types, which I thought were quite interesting.
Including a portrait of George Perkins, Henry Perkins' father,
who
was a highly respected anthropologist at the University of Vermont, right over here.
I think what became really interesting to me about working with the collection is that, unlike working in the studio, where you have pure material, and you know, it's sort of the job of the painter to transform that material into imagery.
To imbue it with meaning.
And to imbue it with meaning. I was working with things which, in their own right, were already full of meaning, and certainly were very strong in terms of imagery. For instance, these small heads, which are from the Philippines, these small ivory heads, which are quite beautiful, and for me seem to be some sort of notion of what was exemplary in the white race, maybe to perhaps a native of the Philippines. And there are other objects on the table here which kind of speak to different cultural traditions.
Sure. This is Charles Dickens over here.
Mm-hmm.
And what about this piece? What meaning did that have for you in this context?
This is, I believe, also from the Philippines.
That's right. Yeah.
It's called Officer Arresting Igorret. And In some ways, it's a very humorous piece, but I think it speaks of control. Here's a figure holding, restraining a figure, and pushing another figure toward the wall. And, you know, as I was looking at the work in the collection, it occurred to me that this show wouldn't merely be a matter of displaying things. It would be a matter of positioning them, trying to create additional meaning through the positioning of objects.
Right, and how objects work one off of another.
Exactly.
Yeah. I mean, there's a nice touch in here where you get one of the gold silhouettes corresponding to this figure, which is almost a silhouette against the wall.
Absolutely. I think also, you know, when we first started this project, you know, I certainly had no idea in what direction it would go. And Janie had originally asked me to come and look at the collection and to select objects which were normally not seen by the public. And I think it was in the process of researching the Fleming Museum itself that I stumbled across the reference to Henry Perkins and the Eugenics Survey of Vermont. And I think that what drove me after a while was this notion that as the director of the Fleming Museum, Perkins was an administrator. He was responsible for this institution and its holdings. And also, at the same time, he was running this very sophisticated survey. So at the same time that he was bringing objects from all over the world into the collection, he was also collecting data on people.
Right.
So I think for me the metaphor was, you know, collecting objects, collecting people.
And also interpreting from that material in both cases.
In both cases.
Yeah.
Drawing conclusions about people without having met them, with having just raw data on them, nationality, age, number of children, economic circumstances. You know, there's not much that we can really ascertain about the maker from this object, but I feel in a way that Perkins was trying to create the same sort of analogies with people that he was studying.
And in many cases, many of the objects that came into this museum and other museums early in the 20th century from quote-unquote primitive cultures were collected out of a kind of curiosity about primitive cultures that
True.
Really fed into the mindset of the time in terms of where Americans and Europeans stood in relation to those cultures.
And speaking of that, this is a remarkable print which I found in the collection. This is an image of the signing of the Mayflower Compact, and it's a mezzotint, which is a type of printmaking process, and I've superimposed over this image text which I found from a eugenics mm-hmm. pamphlet, which was in the possession of Perkins. And I should add at this time that a lot of the material, a lot of the research that I did was by looking at records in Middlesex, Vermont, which is where most of the eugenics office records now reside. And this quote by Leon Whitney, if I can read it, "The good people of America are dying out at an alarming rate. The descendants of that band of Mayflower passengers once numbered many thousands. At the present rate of decline, by the year 2250, all of the remaining descendants can be put back on a boat the size of the Mayflower without overcrowding." And it's kind of a ridiculous statement because one naturally has more descendants rather than fewer descendants.
But it's very telling about their fears and paranoia at
sure.
the time. Yeah.
And I think that this notion of the original band of Mayflower adventurers, if you will, being having the significant strain of stock coming
mm-hmm,
from
mm-hmm.
from the kind of stock which was most valued in America.
That's
I
right.
mean, obviously, it's a completely erroneous idea. And I wanted to also create a kind of dialogue between not only the viewers and the room, but the objects in the room and the room itself,
mm-hmm.
so
mm-hmm.
that the gold leaf, which is on the image here, creates a kind of dialogue between the gold leaf letters that are on the wall
right.
to begin with.
Right.
So as we go around the room, this what I call the normal wall begins to transform suddenly. The gold decals become tarnished. There becomes a presence which is a little bit different than we've seen earlier on in the space. This cast of an African youth set against casts of body parts from Michelangelo's David, which
mm-hmm.
many people feel to be, the sort of ultimate physical,
mm-hmm.
The idea of physical
model.
Perfection
yeah.
in a human being. So as we turn the corner, literally, Vermont begins to turn the corner.
Right.
And I feel that two of Perkins' greatest fears were the fear of the non-white presence and the fear of the subnormal. So these sort of noble, genteel silhouettes, not only do they change in color as we move around the corner, but they become grotesque in a way.
Mm-hmm.
The references are to the grotesque silhouettes of people with macrocephalic and microcephalic conditions.
So these are actual physical ailments that you have introduced into the silhouettes of these individuals.
That's right. And these are the same silhouettes on this side, reversed and then exaggerated
mm-hmm.
through this process
mm-hmm.
of looking at these medical conditions.
And we should also point out that you've introduced some of the symbols from the eugenics survey. This silhouette has a small F in a circle.
Right. The F, which is taken off a chart, which we'll see later, stands for feeble-mindedness, which is one of these vague kind of categories which were ascribed to people with, what we now call, who are mentally challenged
mm-hmm.
and who mentally disabled. And again, as we turn the corner here, there are some more telling events. There's an image, a painting entitled "Laying the Cornerstone," which is an image of the of that particular event here at the Fleming Museum from 1931. And what struck me about the painting was that some of the figures in the periphery, other than Perkins and Perkins's father, George Perkins, and Guy Bailey, the president of the university, were the peripheral figures, the figures of the Italian stoneworkers from Barry and their children, whose faces become somewhat distorted. And again, wanting to call to mind the notion of the importance of the human head in the piece, I thought that was a pretty interesting mm-hmm. characteristic of the painting. And Napoleon is sort of punished here. He's set into the corner as a kind of...
But again, serving as a sign for the ideal classical form.
Sure, absolutely. A very noble kind of, you know, Roman profile, and also wanting to reinforce the notion of profile. I like the double meaning of the word. You know, it refers to seeing somebody from the side, and profile also is kind of a description of merit. You know, what is a person's profile?
Exactly.
What is their worth, their net worth as a being? And again, as we continue to move around the room.
Of the questions that visitors most frequently asked in the installation was, why is this painting upside down? And I think it's a very disturbing thing for most people to see a painting flipped on its head.
Sure. I think my reasons for doing that were varied. I think it's a better painting upside down, first of all. But beyond that, I think its special significance is that Perkins, as did many others, felt that if something wasn't done soon, Vermont would be literally turned on its ear. Mm-hmm. It would be turned upside down. A kind of situation of havoc would ensue if we didn't stop the flood of imperfect people into the state, if we weren't able to correct our own, you know, mistakes of birth. And I think that it's at this point in the room when things really become much more symbolic, and which become maybe more challenging to viewers' normal sensibilities.
If I could
back up just a minute, the idea of working with a permanent collection means, in some ways, trying to change it. Because my job, I felt, with this exhibition was to introduce viewers into a kind of space that was already somewhat familiar to them.
Right.
To challenge these notions of what their expectations were. And I think that many people think of the Fleming Museum as, you know, a great place to come and see art, art which is challenging. But very seldomly do I think people come to the Fleming with this notion that they might be presented with issues of science, issues of this kind of hermetic history. And so, for me, the piece kind of vacillates back and forth between being purely about art, purely about kind of documentary and history, and I think it's in that special condition that I ran into some problems, and that the piece was challenged by a number of viewers as well.
And we'll get into that a little bit later.
Sure.
Let's take a look at the fireplace.
Come over here. The fireplace contains a piece which is entitled The Inflammatories. And The Inflammatories is a video loop of burning logs set into a, you know, realistic maquette of a fireplace hearth. And there are 10 quotes from various eugenicists, from Perkins himself.
From Harriet Abbott, who is the first field worker in
That's
the Eugenics
right.
Survey here.
Yeah, I think even though that Perkins' name comes up most frequently, you have to keep in mind that there were a number of personalities who were involved with the Eugenics Survey. Perkins being, you know, the most visible administrator in a position of considerable power at the university in two places, in the zoology department and at the Fleming Museum. And so The Inflammatories for me is a centerpiece of the show, and it is flanked by a lot of imagery which could be considered transitional, and mostly things from the Fleming's collection. Actually, just about everything from the mantle comes from the Fleming collection, or from my personal sort of trove of objects. Actually, maybe you could take us through some of the the specific things that are on the mantle.
Many of the pieces on the mantle have been shown at the museum in different contexts over the years. This is a small 18th century Flemish painting of a landscape by an artist named Van Deverdon, of, again, a pastoral landscape with farm animals. In this group, there's a photograph of, again, of Henry Perkins' father, George Perkins. And to the left of that is a photograph of a Native American from a large group of photographs that the museum owns by two or three different American or British photographers working in the 19th century, many working for the U.S. government to document the Native Americans.
It has a remarkable title, Whitewash His Face. And I imagine that the photographer's name is Brulé, is that right?
No, it's not. That actually refers to the Native American
type. Oh, it does.
But yeah, this was Alexander Gardner, who was a British photographer. Interestingly, and something that Michael didn't know when he selected this piece, but this one was given to the collection by Henry Perkins.
Oh, really? Huh. I wanted to do a couple of things with the fireplace, as with many of the other vignettes in the room, as I like to call them. I wanted to create something which was at the same time very familiar, and then when you came up close to it and began to examine the discrete parts, very strange. Because for me, you know, the notion was to create a mantle which would contain mementos, toys. There's a stacking kind of toy right there, and a single die, and images from Perkins' own family, as you mentioned. On this side, there's a kind of progression of imagery, you know, from this Native American person to Perkins' father down to the lamb, which is paralleled on the other side, and we'll talk about that in a moment.
Well, let me just jump in here. This piece is from a collection belonging to the museum, given by a Burlington collector in the 19th century, who traveled to the Far East and the Middle East collecting what he called exotica and bric-a-brac, which again I think just shows the idea of collecting during that period in the early 20th century.
Sure.
as amassing bits and pieces of exotic cultures and examples of people different than one.
How would you categorize the nature of objects that were coming into the various types of objects that were coming to the museum at that time? Was it all, you know, top quality stuff?
Not at all. First of all, it was not just what we refer to as the fine arts now. The collections at that point were still geological, zoological, biological, as well as painting, sculpture, and prints.
Sure.
But it was a wide range of things, from, you know, very good examples of different artistic mediums to what we would call souvenirs. You know, mm-hmm. many Vermonters were doing very well and traveling around the world, doing the Grand Tour and collecting souvenirs as they went, and they would bring their collections back to their local museum. And a lot of the objects in the collection, and in fact many of the ones that you've used, came into the museum in that context.
It's interesting too, looking back, I think that most of the objects that I ended up selecting kind of fall into that category of being marginally mm-hmm. of, you know, great artistic merit.
Yes, right.
You know, furniture, there's certainly a lot of crafts, and as you mentioned, bric-a-brac.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, you know, I originally wanted to see Perkins only as a kind of monster. And in looking at objects from the collection and trying to create a personal space, I was tempted to see him much more as a product of his time.
Mm-hmm.
And that includes
sure.
issues such as taste and
yeah.
How one considers one's family members and would display images of those. Maybe we could move along
sure.
and talk a little bit more about what happens on this side. This particular side of the mantelpiece, this second vignette, as I like to call it, features what I've feel are kind of some funny elements. Here's an image which parallels the position of George Perkins on the other side of Charles Darwin, looking down at a monkey, this really beautiful watercolor rendering of a, I believe it's called Portrait of a Monkey with Two Grapes.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the more interesting objects I found in the collection was this postcard, which was sent to someone here at the museum. I'm
yeah,
not exactly
to Robert
sure.
Hall Fleming Robert Hall Fleming.
To Robert
yeah.
Hall Fleming. And it's an image of a man seated next to what appears to be some sort of hat. And on the bottom it says, "Joy, health, and peace. May it be yours on this Christmas day." But the inscription on the back of the card is, "Philippine man just before execution." And I think it's kind of a bizarre,
mm-hmm.
You know, sort of combination of like a joke and some sort of cultural token,
yeah.
a portrait. And, you know, we know nothing of this person, yeah. but I thought, you know, it was kind of interesting that this object made its way into the collection.
But it, again, is representative of objects that I think to the people collecting them, the Americans and Europeans in the early 20th century, they represented examples of savagery and you know, brutality
right.
of a kind that, you know, they felt very proud didn't go on here. There are in the collection a number of weapons, many of them accompanied by documentation that suggests that they were used to kill, you know, such and such person on a specific day.
Right.
So I think it's really, that's a very representative object of, you know, that kind of bizarre aspect of collections of our kind.
And this is one of the, I think, challenges of making a piece like this. And again, it's not representative of all installation
mm-hmm.
art. I mean, I think that, you know, installation art can take the form of Christo's Running Fence,
mm-hmm.
which is an environmental piece, or Robert Smithson's Spiral Jetty, which,
mm-hmm.
you know, has been in the Great Salt Lake for over 20 years now and comes and goes as
right.
the water level changes okay. and as it physically gets shaped by nature. To a piece like Long Shadows or, I mean, even in some ways, works by people like Christoph Wodisko, who projects images onto a building.
Mm-hmm.
They're there for a period of minutes
mm-hmm.
and then they're gone. I think that in this installation, the fine line that I constantly was treading as I was trying to put things together was, am I going to be able to make some sort of statement about the nature of the eugenics survey at the same time that I'm showing all of these fascinating objects?
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, many of these things, if not beautiful, are certainly at least very interesting to look at.
Sure.
And for me, the real line that I was walking was, you know, how do I select something, how do I position it, and then how is it ultimately read so that it says something about that selection, so that it relates
right.
to the eugenics survey. You know, we're talking about issues of race up here. We're
mm-hmm.
talking about
mm-hmm.
Issues of family and natural selection. Mm-hmm. If we were to look down into the coffee table, one of my favorite parts of the show are these two bronze casts, which look very much like Remington casts, even though they're not. They're two bronze casts of cows. And I think that, you know, we've come to think of the cow as Vermont's
That's
animal.
That's right, sure.
But what really struck me about these two was that simply by turning one on its side, the cow suddenly went from mooing,
mm-hmm.
from calling out
mm-hmm.
maybe for its young, to dying. It reminds me of that horse in Picasso's Guernica.
Yes, absolutely.
That seems to be struck down by the flash in the sky.
Right.
And thinking about Darwin, thinking about eugenics, for me the piece really became about survival of the fittest,
mm-hmm.
the strong
mm-hmm.
stock over here, and the dying or the weaker stock, and
yeah.
how the eugenics survey was in some ways intent on keeping the strong stock and,
mm-hmm.
and somehow doing away with those weaker.
This is also a really wonderful example of what artists can do with museum collections that curators cannot do. I think that curators are trained in a way that there's a relatively narrow way that the work can be shown within a museum. There are kind of accepted parameters and contexts in which artwork is shown.
Well, does it, I mean, in your mind, does this destroy this object?
Not at all. Not at all. It adds another meaning. And I mean, it takes it out of its normal context in which you would talk about it. And you know, it enters into a different kind of meaning in the piece.
Well, maybe I'm a little unclear on exactly what it is that a curator can and cannot do. Why would this be, you know, in bad form for a curator to take this kind of action with an object and positioning it?
Now, in this particular case, and in all of the cases in the gallery, none of the work has been harmed by the way that,
right.
that we have installed it.
Right.
But I guess it's more than anything, it's out of respect, from the curatorial perspective, out of respect for the original intention of the artist.
Right, which I've completely violated here.
Yes, but that's why curators invite artists to use the collections.
In fact, this whole table, this coffee table arena, I like to think of it, because it's a massive object in the center of the room, is kind of about taking those same liberties to the extreme. This coffee table is actually a relief map, which is from the Perkins Geology Museum, which is next door to the Fleming. And the Perkins Geology Museum is named after the father, George Perkins, who was an eminent anthropologist and geologist in the state, very well respected at the university. And I remember seeing this thing as a kid over there.
It was actually in the Fleming Museum before it went over to Perkins. And it was created as part of the Eugenics Survey.
That's right. And it's the map is in its original form when I found it to include it in the exhibition here was about 3 feet higher. It was a waist level map at the museum, the Geology Museum, which you could look at and locate various states, various towns throughout the state. And the legend on the map says relief model of Vermont, produced for the Vermont Commission on Country Life. And I was so far into the project that when I saw the map for the first time, I didn't even realize what I was looking at.
Right.
But the Vermont Commission on Country Life was kind of a spin-off study group from the Eugenics Survey. It was a commission composed of 200 intellectual Vermonters in the late 1920s who spent over a year interviewing people throughout the state to produce this work entitled Rural Vermont. And Rural Vermont was a kind of record of the think tank procedures of the Vermont Commission on Country Life, which included such recommendations to the state as eliminating billboards as a way of attracting tourists to Vermont.
And
you would think that
implemented.
It was right, yeah. And it was implemented. It's with us to this day. You know, the landscape is unbesmirched unbesmirched by billboards. But one of the really interesting things was that it was not done to merely increase tourism. The idea was to attract a better class of summer and year-round resident to Vermont, doctors, lawyers, and ad campaigns such as the ones undertaken by the Vermont Commission on Country Life were aimed at major metropolitan areas. In fact, this brochure, this is a facsimile of a brochure produced for the Vermont Commission on Country Life, says, only a step to unspoiled Vermont. And it says, an uncrowded scenic frontier for healthful country life and fun. And the image on the front of the brochure is an image of Vermont, a kind of country image. And then inset is what I assume to be some sort of cityscape of New York or Boston. And as we go through the brochure, it presents itself ostensibly as a tourist brochure. Images of the state, a kind of crude map. Only a step to unspoiled Vermont, a continuous natural park. So, what we had to offer was a kind of idyllic landscape where not only the landscape was untouched, but there was, in fact, a kind of rawness to the population, which they were hoping to somehow improve upon. So, for me, I wanted to create a kind of literal conversation place or piece. I think many people think of their coffee tables as this site of casual connections with friends. Here there are some drinks out as if there was a conversation which recently took place.
Right.
Copies of Fortune magazine, which introduce I think an element of irony into the piece, which is something that I think we should talk about.
That's
because I think that many of the objects in the show really speak directly to notions of irony and in some cases humor, but in most places,
for instance, surrounding the map of Vermont in the large case are hundreds and hundreds of test tubes.
That's right. The test tubes, for me, kind of symbolize a controlling element. I mean, they flank the state much in the way that, New Hampshire and New York would. But here, these other states have been replaced with a kind of reference to technology and the future, certainly medicine, medical history, and the processes which were being utilized on Vermonters once the sterilization laws were passed. I mean, people were sterilized.
Right.
Over 200 Vermonters, mostly women, were sterilized in these $30 operations, which had to be approved by the state after three doctors agreed on the appropriateness of this action.
Yeah.
Based on what they felt was a very considered opinion that this person or these persons were not capable of successfully reproducing, and more importantly, they felt they shouldn't reproduce.
Right, that's right.
So I think I tried to create some situations in the room which are deliberately surreal, bombastic in a way, kind of
disturbing.
Jarring,
very disturbing. A very jarring image.
Let's continue to move around there.
Now, at this point, I want to point out that you, I believe, had seen actual photographs of Perkins's study and didn't try to reproduce it. I mean, that was not the intent here.
Well, about halfway through the process of working with the museum's collections, Merlin Acom, who's the preparator here, who installs all the exhibits, asked me if I wanted to see photographs of Perkins' actual office here at the Fleming. And I immediately said no. I don't want to be influenced by how closely I am or I'm not following that model intuitively.
Yeah.
Because you what you have to keep in mind, and I think what separates this from an historical recreation in a museum, say a history museum or a science museum, is that this room, as you see it, never existed. It is a psychological model, I think, of Perkins as a person, as a container for a value system which was in some way superimposed over the Eugenics Survey and over the state. I mean, I really think of the room as Perkins himself.
Mm-hmm.
And so therefore, there are things in the room which function as they need to in order to convince you that it is a workspace.
Right.
But there are also many things in the room which go beyond that notion of a normal workaday space. The fact that the silhouettes on the walls begin to increase in size mm-hmm. and discolor and mm-hmm. become, you know, finally around his desk, gigantic,
I
think expresses for me some sort of state of mind of Perkins. The fear, as I mentioned earlier, of the subnormal. And so when I finally saw the photographs of Perkins' office, I was shocked because it was a very Spartan environment.
Mm-hmm.
There was a desk not unlike this one that was in the office. A few display cases which featured, interestingly enough, Japanese fans.
Right.
And there was an ashtray and very little evidence of clutter. I mean, I'm sure that the photographer really prepared the mm-hmm. room for mm-hmm. these sort of room portraits. But I think that those photographs of the room are every bit as telling about Perkins and his sort of nature as an administrator as this place is. Here I've tried to gather various aspects of his life into one place. His interest as a scientist, as an administrator, his interest to a certain degree in art and photography. Mm-hmm. He was mm-hmm. an amateur photographer. And I think that what emerges from all of this research and from looking at the Fleming's collection is that the installation had to be kind of larger than life. Because ultimately, even though Perkins in some ways seemed to be kind of a reserved person, I think his actions ultimately are larger than life. They affect life. They affect the lives and affected the lives of many hundreds of people.
The other thing, though, that really, you know, is a large part of this installation and of any artwork is the artist's feeling about the material that they're dealing with.
True.
So, you know, I think it's definitely worth noting that your feelings about, you know, that you had on learning about the Eugenics Survey, you know, as a Vermonter, as someone who grew up here, you know, must have been very disturbing, and that certainly, you know, plays a role in the imagery that you see in
That's
the room.
That's true. Being from this area, I wanted to work very hard to make sure that I was fair to that time period,
mm-hmm.
in a way. That may sound a little strange, but I wanted to make sure that that I did my research down to finding the right telephone, finding the right frame with which to contain an image. And I think that kind of attitude partly is wrapped up in wanting this piece to be perceived as being by a Vermonter.
Mm-hmm.
I have certainly strong feelings about where I'm from and where I grew up, as did Perkins.
Mm-hmm.
And I have certain prejudices. You know, I feel that this is a terrific place to live. And of course, I grew up not as one of a member of one of the target groups that Perkins would have been interested in. You know, white middle class family. And I wanted to make sure that all the efforts that I made were toward giving at least Vermont a fair shake. And I think that a lot of the questions I had growing up about the nature of this place were answered in doing this mm-hmm. eugenics research. Mm-hmm. The fact that, you know, there are no billboards mm-hmm. always was very interesting to me as a child. And when I'm finally able to move beyond that as what seems to be like a good idea into the sort of realization that this law was also part and parcel of a larger project to kind of clean up Vermont ultimately, genetically, to see it in a totally different perspective, you know, it becomes kind of sinister. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. it makes me now look to the landscape with a certain kind of regret or misgiving.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, that's very disturbing. Mm-hmm. And I know that those are some feelings that people have experienced mm-hmm. walking into this space.
That's right.
And how could this happen here?
Yeah.
How could there be this kind of ideology at work in the Green Mountain State?
Mm-hmm. Yes, certainly in the responses that we received in the comment book, there were a lot of very strong feelings, mm-hmm. you know, on the part of visitors, exactly that kind of response. Well, some of the objects on the desk show examples of early exhibits at the museum, which are very interesting. I talked about before about how there were geological and zoological specimens shown at the museum in the early days. Examples like this of exhibits that would have been around when Perkins was director in the early days of the museum.
So the museum really had the flavor of like a natural history museum, which I think is part of what informed what you now see here. I'm very interested in imagery which comes out of places like science before mm-hmm. it comes out of art.
Mm-hmm.
The process of research is really important to me, and obviously I had to do a lot of research to create this piece.
Yeah.
And some of the forms that I've become interested in over the years have to do with this kind of quantitative and qualitative display of information. The diorama,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
the collector's box, the killing jar for an insect collector. The kind of material that is at one time incredibly functional and at the same time accidentally kind of beautiful
mm-hmm.
or develops with its own kind of aesthetic. And I think that for me, making installations is a kind of hunting process. It involves the accident, you know, being willing and able to act on the notion of the accident, and to maybe recognize in some object, which is not a particularly interesting object at one time, you know, the potential for it being transformed into something else. For instance, this is one of my favorite objects on the desk. It's a, I don't know if you'll be able to read this, but it's a box of pins, banker's pins. And the maker of the banker's pins is a company called Puritan, which, you know, I think that if you have your eyes open in the installation and you come and see it and you come and see it again, you begin to pick up on some of the metaphors that are involved in the selection of the objects.
I think that's the most important thing in going through the installation as a visitor, is just bearing in mind that every object in here, you know, bears some symbolic or metaphoric relationship to the whole story.
Absolutely, every object. And I think that that might seem impossible, but I think that in choosing something to merely flesh out the realism of the room,
mm-hmm.
like this chair, for instance, and going for the period, there was also something else that happened. You know, I looked to the object and began to sort of ask it questions. You know, does this reveal a kind of use? Does mm-hmm. it reveal a kind of character as an object? And I think the fact that this is a kind of a drab chair,
yes. Classic 1930s office chair.
Exactly, you know, really says something about like the nature of the person that might have been using it. And also I wanted to kind of de-emphasize the secretary as kind of a peripheral person to Perkins. I mean, I really think of a person in control, a person mm-hmm. dictating, a person giving orders, and being efficient and running the museum as well as the Eugenics Survey with an element of assuredness.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, let's continue to move around the room.
Tell us about this object, which clearly has symbolic intent.
Absolutely. As I mentioned earlier, this object represents Perkins' fear of the non-white. Maybe perhaps we could walk over here and address the whole space. Perkins' desk is flanked by this massive portrait of a pinhead. And on the right-hand side and on the left-hand side, one half of a Rorschach inkblot. And just to refresh everyone's memory, Hermann Rorschach invented his inkblot psychological profiles in 1931, again, mm-hmm. also coincidentally with the opening of the Fleming Museum. And for me, the Rorschach, other than being a test of psychological condition, is also in itself kind of an interesting image. And I chose this one because it most, for me, resembled a bird skull in this particular part of the image. And Perkins was an amateur ornithologist, or more appropriately, a bird watcher. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to pick a Rorschach inkblot, of which there are 10, to more directly symbolize his personal fears. And at the center of the inkblot is this anthropological cast of an African man. These casts, I believe, came into the collection
early in the 20th century for use in teaching anthropology, and
that's
Perkins'
right.
father, George Perkins, used them in his anthro lectures at the University of Vermont. And then they were accessioned into the museum's collection, and then for many years they were over at the anthro department, and have
that's
just
right.
come back to the museum for this installation and will remain here.
So these 10 casts, you know, finding them was really a remarkable event, because not only was there the possibility of repatriating them to the museum, but for me it seemed significant that they were lost to the museum somehow, as if, you know, this was a part of the museum's history that was a little less desirable. And in fact, many of the eugenics survey records that I found had been jettisoned from the university. These were things which were no longer so directly connected to, to this place. And as we move from the Rorschach, which incidentally is entitled Gollum, and there are several pieces around the room which have individual titles. As was mentioned earlier, the fireplace is known as the Inflammatories. Gollum, you know, for me is a kind of nightmare figure. And it is Perkins' nightmare, is the nightmare of anyone who is from a minority group, or who is somehow marginalized by science or institutions or history. So as we continue to move, there's a really interesting image which we found that, for me, is just such a remarkable comparison, and it has to do with this notion of using the human head as a kind of touchstone for the entire piece. This watercolor image, Italian?
By Thomas Rowlandson, English.
By English. Yeah. Thomas Rowlandson features sort of an angry woman next to a crawling demon, and then a baying dog, some sort of dog/pig animal, next to a chained African man. And all of the images are so grotesque in execution and in color and in what they suggest. It became further enhanced by the discovery of this frame that we found, which
it really accentuates the image. Yeah,
absolutely, and it seems to be a good buffer between the kind of tar-like surface of Gollum and then this very ornate classical Baroque frame.
Now, the title of this piece is called Comparative Physiognomy, and there's another example of a piece
that's
over
right.
here on the other side of the desk that was a kind of a part of the study of physiognomy in the 19th century, even much earlier than that, in which comparisons were made between humans and animals. It lost favor early on and was kind of treated as a joke, and I think certainly by the time he made that, it was not taken seriously.
Not unlike phrenology
and
the study of character through examining the physical shape of
That's
the human
right,
head.
Which certainly is closely related to
Absolutely. Humans. I think, you know, this is a really important thing to keep in mind, because so much of the rhetoric of eugenics I believe, comes out of a very uninformed place scientifically.
That's right.
I think the eugenicists were getting input from the religious community, from certainly people from different classes about, you know, the ascendancy of race. And I think that the, you know, an image like this really typifies the kind of fantasy quality of these studies and how really truly unscientific they actually were.
I think that's very true.
The one of the most important pieces in the show for me is Perkins Speaks. And Perkins Speaks is a half-hour videotape, which is also looped like the fireplace. And it's projected over this 19th century landscape painting. Do you recall the artist? It's a French painting, I believe.
Yes, it is a French painting.
And when I first encountered the painting, I assumed that it was a painting of Vermont landscape, and, you know, incorrectly so. But for me, I think that, the presence of the cow as kind of this animal symbolically, mm-hmm. which is associated with Vermont, created a very important metaphor, and the lightness of the painting, in a way, made it a perfect screen for this projection of Perkins.
Yeah. Now, tell us a little bit about the video. One of the issues that has come up in the course of the installation is the relationship between historical fact and artistic invention in a work like this, which is heavily dependent on historical record.
Right.
So to what extent in the video is this individual dealing with actual historical material?
Well, I think that the whole installation has to be looked at with this kind of eye to metaphor.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly Perkins Speaks is the most liberal of the elements in terms of how it interprets history or reinterprets history. But in fact, the text which I wrote is based on Perkins' own correspondence, mm-hmm. letters to and from Perkins. It is based on eugenical propaganda,
mm-hmm.
Of which Perkins collected many hundreds of examples of pamphlets from various eugenics surveys around the country, most notably from Cold Spring Harbor in Long Island. And basically, what I tried to do is take the most kind of self-incriminating passages from these letters and from these pamphlets and string them together with a very general kind of text.
Yeah.
I tried to be what I felt was faithful to the language of the period. Many people have assumed that incorrectly, and again, perhaps this is my fault or our fault in terms of putting the exhibition together, have incorrectly assumed that this is Perkins speaking. And it is, in fact, an actor,
mm-hmm.
a terrific theater teacher and lawyer from New York City named Nicholas Lobenthal. And I knew Nick when I was quite younger and remembered how much he resembled Perkins. So, like many things in this show, which were kind of stumbled across, I went through my mental Rolodex, came up with Nick, and we got together, and he agreed very graciously to be Perkins. Some of what you hear is ad-libbing. You know, he's an actor, and he sort of got into the character. But largely, I think that the sentiment expressed mm-hmm. in this is very indicative of the sentiments of eugenicists and Perkins at the time, sure.
And in response to just a couple of people early on when the installation opened who expressed concern about, specifically about the video and the mix of fact and fiction, we have made it clear to visitors that this is not an historical documentation
sure.
or reconstruction of anything. It is an artwork at heart, at bottom.
It was tough for me to remember that at times. I think that one of the most difficult aspects of putting together a work like this is knowing when you can cross the line and when you cannot, and also acknowledging that I think sometimes you have to cross that line in order to make a point. I think to the casual observer of the eugenics records, there might not be anything so compelling or damaging about them. And when I began to look at those records, I was struck by the kind of banal quality of the information: charts, pedigrees, handwritten note cards, and pulling all of these things together was a task that luckily I had a lot of help with. And in fact, when I stumbled across these references to Perkins and eugenics, I thought I was blazing this sort of new trail of information. As it turns out, a scholar named Kevin Dan in 1991 originally discovered these records, which were at that time stored in Waterbury at the State Mental Hospital. And Perkins wrote a brief piece for Vermont History magazine, which talked about
Kevin
the... Kevin Dan wrote a brief piece for Vermont History magazine, which outlined kind of the basic structure of the survey.
Right. Which was the first thing that had been written on the eugenics survey, was that not right?
For years, yeah. Because I think, you know, memories are short, and I think that since this stuff was kind of disposed after 1936, was held onto by the university and ultimately rechanneled, it had just faded from memory. For some people, and obviously those that it affected spent a lifetime of living with their sterilizations and with their knowledge of how the survey affected them and their families. So there were some advantages for me that someone had been there beforehand, and I was able to correspond with Kevin and also Nancy Gallagher, who is currently working on her master's thesis in history here at the University of Vermont. You know, their input was invaluable, as was the input from Charles Delaney, also known as Soaring Eagle, who is the cultural ambassador to the United States from the sovereign Abenaki nation of Missisquoi. And Charles was one of the people who impressed upon me the need for considering the story of the Abnakis.
Right.
And rather than focusing on any one particular group in this piece, I chose to focus on Perkins. And again, I think that many people felt that specific voices were left out of the installation. But in some ways, there was very little information on any of the people who were affected by the sterilization law.
That's right.
And so I began to focus on the phenomenon of these sterilizations and of the law itself and of Perkins's life as kind of this broader container in some way for the information.
And one of our hopes for the afterlife of this installation is that perhaps it could encourage or, you know, stimulate the voices that have not been heard, people
true.
Who were deeply affected by the eugenics survey, you know, to somehow come forth and you know, put their stories, make
That's
their stories
right.
part of the historical record.
Well, I think there are some, when you begin to make political work, I think there are a lot of responsibilities that come with that, whether
sure.
you want them or not. And in this case, I've learned that this piece has created a real public debate and some pretty interesting dialogue about history and about who is represented in history, who gets to make laws, who gets to establish public and scientific policy. And if nothing else, perhaps this piece can create additional debate for the need for communication, the need for not forgetting about certain historic events, but for reliving them and rehashing them and representing them in such a way that they can be understood as we learn more about you know, our identity as people who live in this state, as our identity of you know, people who come from a multicultural society. And people who have different responsibilities, like artists and curators and scientists, how these things can all interrelate.
Yeah, exactly. And I think in some of the programming that was done at the museum in connection with the exhibition, some very valuable dialogues were begun that hopefully
That's
can
true.
Continue.
In fact, that programming, I think, yielded some of the most interesting, or created some very interesting context for that discussion. The symposium, which featured several scientists, philosophers, historians,
sociologists,
genetic researcher. If nothing else, created a great deal of interest in reopening this piece of history for discussion. Because I think that in the shadow of the Human Genome Project, in the shadow of Bosnia, and these camps where people have been detained, in the shadow of
discussions such as the bell curve.
Absolutely, yeah. and in assessing the role of eugenics in the Second World War, and the interest that the Nazis had in eugenics, which, interestingly enough, was based on American research,
mm-hmm.
Which is something I did not know before I started this project. I think we have to understand how there's this ripple effect which is created, where an idea becomes an ideology, and the ideology then becomes policy.
Yes. Yeah.
This area of the exhibition is the most cluttered, and I refer to it as the laboratory, even though it is more of a place of, I would say, kind of the fiddlings of a hobbyist rather than of a hardcore scientist. Here we see slides, thousands of glass lantern slides, which were part of the zoology department's collection. And a great many of these slides were used in the heredity course, which was taught here at UVM, which was initiated by Perkins, but then later was not taught by Perkins, although many of these images were used up into the late 50s and early 60s.
And how did you come upon these thousands of lantern slides?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, serendipity, for me,
plays
at least,
a big role in your art.
Plays a big role in my art. And what I mean by that is, as I begin to focus my energy on a project and begin to learn how to look for components and learn how to ask for information, sometimes things happen. And in this particular case, I was fortunate enough to be commissioned to design a mural for my former high school, Champlain Valley Union, which is in Hinesburg. And the mural, which addressed the subject of the obsolescence of information, became a real sort of hunt and peck kind of project for me. I was trying to create a 40-foot-long mural that was half painting, half sculpture. And for the sculptural components, I was looking for educational materials which in some way were obsolete. And I went to David Ely, who was my former biology teacher at Champlain Valley Union, and asked him if he had any scientific instruments which were damaged or broken or which came from a time which rendered them kind of obsolescent now, you know, in 1995, at this time, 1994. And I went to David, and he sort of turned me loose on a room which had broken oscilloscopes and microscopes and the parts for a Van de Graaff generator, you know, real boy stuff,
yeah.
Real little boy stuff. And I found socked away in the corner these wooden boxes filled with thousands of slides. And I asked him where these were from, and he said that they had come to him through many hands from the University of Vermont's biology department. And additionally, there were 40 or 50 charts that were shoved into a bag in the corner of the same room. And I began to pull out the charts and look at them, and the imagery contained in the charts related to genetics. Charts which were about inherited characteristics such as baldness, such as you know, blood diseases and things along those lines, hemophilia.
Mm-hmm.
And the final and most impressive object that I found in the bag was this chart which is behind us now as we speak. It is a roughly 12-foot long hand-lettered chart on a kind of muslin fabric. Which shows the pedigree of two boys at the Vermont Industrial School, which was in Vergennes. And this chart is clearly based on a number of the smaller pedigrees that were produced for the Eugenics Survey of Vermont based on national models. And there are some of those models are to the left of us, actually, at the other end of the chart. Right, we see a pedigree of a family with a high incidence of cataracts. We see specific families, certainly their pseudonyms, the Harishaw family of boat builders. And these pedigree models were used by eugenicists all over the country to kind of establish proof that these characteristics were being handed from generation to generation and costing the various states money.
And they were also done, as I recall, of the well-bred families, in their view,
True, and so you can find pedigrees of, for instance, Franklin Roosevelt's family, of Abraham Lincoln's family, and these were in some ways produced merely to create kind of a contrast with these obviously poorer models. I mean, it's perhaps no surprise that you find higher degrees of alcoholism and premature mortality in families which are poor. And I think the eugenicists felt that this was, you know, really concrete proof that these people were drags on the welfare rolls and were sucking up money from the various states that they were from. And I was surprised to find this chart, mostly because the charts that I had previously seen at Middlesex were smaller and not so impressive in terms of scale. And it was several months later that it was pointed out to me that this chart, I believe Nancy Gallagher pointed out to me that this chart was actually a display chart produced for the 1932 International Eugenics Congress, which was held at the American Museum of Natural History. That's right.
In New York.
That's right. So so the chart really is a remarkable document, and finding it, again, was one of these serendipitous events which helped me create another centerpiece for the show. As it turns out, the progression of how the documents got to Dave Ely sort of goes as follows. Perkins gave them to his colleague Paul Moody, who was at the university, who gave them to Lyman Rowell, who later became president of the university. Rowell, in turn, passed them on to Dick Glade, who was David Ely's teacher, and then Dave inherited them from Dick Glade. And so these documents came to CVU in the 1970s and were completely useless because of their racist content, and so were just ignored and stored.
But not thrown away, fortunately.
But not thrown away, I think maybe because of their intrinsically historical appeal. Certainly some of the charts were very beautiful, if not kind of outdated in terms of the information. I mean, everybody's, has a tough time getting rid of stuff of sort of historical significance.
And analogous things happened in other eugenic surveys around the country. The records for Cold Spring Harbor had been, as I understand it, deaccessioned from Cold Spring Harbor.
That's right.
And were elsewhere and were in danger of being thrown away and were recently rescued by a number of people in that area.
That's right. Maybe we can move over to the light table. This light table is another, I feel, significant component in the installation, and it has had the distinction during the tenure of the show to be the most manipulated object. even though people aren't supposed to touch things in the space, somehow they were compelled to select slides on their own for inclusion in here.
There's been a lot of rearranging going on.
That's right. What I've tried to do in this particular area is sort through the cases which were titled variously evolution, human genetics, the evolution of man, animal evolution, embryology, morphology. And I tried to present a kind of collage of images which were, I think, significant in terms of relationships between images.
Right.
And there are images of embryos and of cave paintings and of fingerprints. There is an image, and I don't know if it's possible to see this, but there is an image of Hitler's ear, which was part of a morphology comparison that eugenicists were interested in, comparing ear types from statues from antiquity to present-day people to see how they had evolved.
And there's a whole range of ear images.
That's right. This ear, in fact, is an ear of Abraham Lincoln, the ear of Abraham Lincoln, one of them. And so I think that the comparison between Hitler's ear and Lincoln's ear is interesting. Even if you're not aware of who they belong to, it is the kind of comparison strategy that I'm interested in.
Mm-hmm.
Here's an image of Charles Davenport, who was a key figure in the American eugenics movement. And next to him is Francis Galton, coiner of the term eugenics. There are images of twins, of babies born with of tails, which later sort of died off after they became older. A comparison of two African-American men who were mistakenly identified. One was mistakenly identified for the other in a famous murder case. images of human fingerprints and examples of other pedigrees from other eugenics surveys. So I guess unlike a painting or a drawing where you're focused on a lot of the formal aspects of the image itself and the subject matter, I wanted here to create a kind of do-it-yourself visual experience where you were able to make certain kinds of comparisons, eliminate certain details, and accept others into your, into again, your mental Rolodex of associations.
And in watching people go through the installation, I noticed that people tended to spend a very long time here, and really, I know you could see them making comparisons and you know, coming to realizations at this point in the installation. I think this was a really important piece.
I think that's true. This laboratory area also, for me, helps create a kind of sense of this working space and the workings of Perkins's head. You know, we see him as a family man, we see him as an administrator, we also see him as an organizer of data and as a teacher, which I think is important because even as the director of the Eugenics Survey, I think he's sort of teaching Vermont a lesson and bringing this sort of discrete set of knowledge to a place which didn't, you know, which didn't have these interests at stake as public policy before. We can wander back and take a look at some other elements in the piece. This is an area of the piece which many people have asked me questions about. And here's one of those instances where you do things out of a kind of necessity rather than any kind of symbolic import. The golem is created by a very complex system of pins and rope tethers and chicken wire, and it is stuffed with newspaper. Finally, it receives a layer of spray foam insulation to create the texture that you see, and then that is that. Then I work that with joint compound in order to create kind of smoother areas. The final layer is a mixture of oil and tar, and I like the associations between this notion of tar and then this figure of an African man, the notion of tarring a figure, kind of to shame a figure. But the bottom part with this stack of books is really about covering up some sloppiness in the installation. And I was looking for some sort of device to do this in a subtle way, and I happened upon a set of 40 volumes of a 1907 encyclopedia. And I like this idea of a stack of unread books, as if here was all this information that Perkins was choosing to ignore. To ignore these other voices, to ignore facts in a way. So the books remain unread. They kind of function as furniture. In fact, there are stacks of books around the room which have very revealing titles. The Dancing Mouse by Robert Yerkes, which is a famous treatise on evolution. Books by Aldous Huxley, books by Charles Darwin. And so, you know, this constituted the bulk of the real serious reading material of Perkins. The table itself is also perhaps in this case more about this classical notion of still life as opposed to being about any real set of information. This is my notion of a kind of scientific workplace and a place where there are all kinds of informed and uninformed processes being gone through. The idea of experimentation, the idea of pure research, the idea of play. Because again, from all accounts, Perkins was considered somewhat of a dilettante as a scientist. His primary area of research before he got into eugenics was actually jellyfish. And I think that it's interesting to kind of keep in perspective how a professional person reacquaints themselves with their craft. As a bird watcher, I think Perkins felt he was really engaging with a kind of scientific study and a kind of scientific process. But in the eugenics survey, all kinds of data were collected with the idea in mind that the information that they were going after was, you know, that they would find it, that they would find evidence to back up their claims.
Which is contrary to the scientific method.
Exactly. And it certainly is not like a notion of pure research. So in here, there is this kind of mysterious purpose which exists among these still life objects. And I think that's further exemplified by this little carving, which is in the table. This table is a 18th century?
Referred to as a shuffleboard table.
A shuffleboard table. English?
I believe so, yeah. And it could be assumed then that this was some sort of a gaming area.
And I think that, again, a way that I have to work with objects in creating installations is finding something, have it acquire meaning over time, think about it. As in some previous pieces, I began to dream about this place and dream about Perkins. And I think that's one of the things which lends the room a kind of dreamlike atmosphere. Perhaps more, people have commented, more nightmare-like. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think to come into this room with expectations of having a kind of clear presentation of history and of Perkins is, you know, it's wrong, but at the same time, there's something about the combination of colors and objects and images which almost certainly adds up to a kind of disturbing place.
Absolutely. And I was struck in a number of cases in the objects you chose that you really had kind of an intuitive sense of what they were about.
Yeah.
I mean, there were aspects of them that you didn't know until... well, I think it's more than luck. I think it's an integral part of your working process.
Well, I suppose... like becoming good at drawing or becoming a good house painter or a plumber.
You become good at understanding the meaning in objects.
Exactly. And I think for me, I'm always on alert for kind of, you know, these symbolic parameters and how things fit into them. And we looked at a great many objects. There are 18,000 objects here at the Fleming. And I don't know how many we looked at, but certainly a large
percentage of the...
And there was another interest that I had in wanting to pick objects that really hadn't been seen very much beforehand.
Exactly.
In certain cases, we felt we had to rely on certain things because, for instance, this table has been shown and... But there are certainly a number of objects which have not been shown
and
for 50 years.
That's right, and that was one of my motivations in asking you to do this, because it's really just a terrific collection that contains a lot of very unusual, interesting, and bizarre objects that have very no context for being exhibited at the museum. But it's really a shame not to show them. And rather than, I mean, you know, as a curator, I could bring them all out and put them in the cases and, you know,
well, that was our original idea.
Of things, exactly.
Sure.
But
the remarkable thing about this experience for me as an artist was being getting permission, in a way, official permission to take the idea as far as it could go.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the fact that the piece went from a display of objects in the museum fashion to research which led to the possibility of a broader kind of display mechanism, a more intense display mechanism, is really... an important part of how the show evolved. And I think that it is the dialogue that I engaged with the dialogue that happened between Janie and I, which ultimately led to the, I think, successful manufacture of this space. And I think that, you know, you were hopefully still able to function as the curator in the selection process, because I think the dialogue that was created, you know, how's this object? Well, it's a pretty interesting object. We've shown it before.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what about this object? I've never even seen that object,
right.
You know. That's, you know, there became a kind of, it was like editing a film,
mm-hmm.
in a way. There was this idea of let's throw a bunch of ideas out there, see which ones are good, see which ones really hold up, and then go with those. And as difficult as it seems to believe, we actually edited out a lot of stuff from
an
this.
An enormous amount of it.
From this exhibit, and I think that in a larger environment that may have been more possible to include that stuff, but at the same time...
It would have been overwhelming.
It would have been overwhelming, and I think it's just about at that point right now. And there were a lot of logistical problems that we had to overcome. For instance, all of the walls in this room were built for the exhibition. In other words, it wasn't desirable or possible to paint large silhouettes directly on the museum walls without an incredible amount of repainting. So what you're looking at
These were here, but these two walls, the two walls with the silhouettes were
actually constructed. No, you're mistaken. All of these walls were built.
Oh, I'm sorry. You're absolutely right. In front of the existing walls.
In front of the existing walls. So there's over 100 feet of running walls, which Merlin Akam and I constructed for the show, which means that parts of the work can be salvaged, perhaps, as separate, almost more sculptural elements, and the rest of it will be destroyed. And again, this speaks, I think, to the nature of installation art. I'm primarily a painter, and I came to installation art as a way of showcasing my paintings in a better context. I began to be disillusioned with the kinds of spaces that I was given to show my work in. So the first moves were painting the walls a different color. And that would somehow connect the paintings in a kind of sequential way to show them maybe more as a suite of works or connected through that color. And then as my opportunities to create installations became greater, as the number of opportunities increased, and I began to write grants and expend more of my own money, the program for me began to think more about architecture and about changing the nature of the gallery space. Because even though this is in a museum, I was interested in getting as far away from the museum environment as possible.
So this has really completely transformed the space, which is part of our larger gallery.
That's right. I think, you know, if I had had my druthers and was able to overcome problems with the fire code and lighting and electricity, I would have liked to drop the ceiling down, put a tin ceiling in.
I'm sure.
And I think that, you know, as I continue to make these pieces, the idea will be to more fully transform this place into a kind of metaphoric separate environment from whatever environment you happen to encounter it.
Yeah.
And maybe we should talk a little bit about the closet.
So this is the piece that connects the installation to an information room in which we present a great amount of historical material on the eugenics movement and the eugenics survey. But the closet is very much a part of the installation.
I don't think I could have made the piece without the closet, because I think it addresses some of what became ultimately some of the criticisms and concerns of viewers to the piece. When Kevin Dann encountered the Eugenics Survey records in 1991, I think he realized, as did I much later when I came across the same information, that these documents had literally been in the closet for 50 years, mm-hmm. 60 years. And I felt that if I was going to make something in this space which was as metaphorical and as kind of much imbued with hyperbole as this space is, that I better back up those suggestions with some of my actual research. And this idea of research manifested itself in recreations of documents, mm-hmm. and a kind of scholarly writing which Janie produced based on some of the research of Kevin and Nancy Gallagher and others to really create, I think, a very readable to create, I guess, the greater context for this piece. And in passing through the closet, you make this transition from the private world of Perkins into the public sphere of revelation and of knowledge.
And also from an artwork into historical fact.
That's right.
The closet itself is a masterpiece of trompe l'oeil.
Well, I think that the closet is where I was able to rely on my interests as a forger and
yes.
a kind of faker of art and documents to create a space which has a different feel.
Mm-hmm.
So the closet was designed to be a little beat up,
yeah.
and to certainly be a space of, you know, frequent use.
And a very personal space. I mean, you see little notes scrawled on the wall and the heights
right.
of children recorded on the right here.
Well, this is I'm glad you mentioned this. This is, I think, for me, a very personal part of the piece. When I was growing up, my grandfather, who was from Bennington, had in his home a section of door on which he measured, you know, he recorded data about all of his grandchildren and nieces and nephews and friends.
Yeah.
And so over the years, you know, I would visit him at that place from when I was born to about age 17 or 18 when they finally moved away. This door became covered with hundreds of names and heights.
Yeah.
And it became difficult to see after a while. It was like a blur of information. And so I began to think about Perkins wanting to document his own family in a way which was, I think, kind of chillingly related to how he was keeping tabs on the rest of the state of Vermont. And I just wanted to create a kind of metaphor. So here we see early on in the process of recording the heights and ages of various friends and children and his, you know, his own height recorded and the height of his father. And I was going to fill it with hundreds of names, but then I realized that, wait a minute, you know, this is supposed to be circa 1940, and he wouldn't have completed this project. It would just be getting going. So you're right, the closet is full of little bits of information and quirky objects. This is a photograph which I found in some sort of anonymous family album, and it's of a massive watermelon, I believe from Texas. And this was the kind of thing that I thought would lend perhaps a much needed spot of humor to a piece which was about a kind of disturbing subject matter. So little things are tucked away, little notes to himself. In fact, inside the closet, there is an article, a clipping from Perkins' own scrapbook about a car accident that he was involved in which a man died. Colonel Allen was struck by a car driven by Perkins. I believe it was in 1915, and it was completely an accident, but Perkins felt compelled somehow to include this in his own personal scrapbook. Mm-hmm. And he kept extensive scrapbooks relating to the Eugenics Survey. Mm-hmm. In fact, we have some articles from the scrapbook reproduced in the information room. And I think the scrapbook is a really interesting record of his objectivity in some ways about what he was doing. Mm-hmm. I think he was, even though there was not a great deal of criticism at the time, I think he was ready to sort of acknowledge it.
Right.
And to, which maybe even strengthened his own convictions that he was able to so objectively respond to critics. Mm-hmm. And as I mentioned, at the time there were not many of his project.
Yeah.
So the closet contains many, many elements which are, again, somewhat humorous.
Mm-hmm.
The box of white owl cigars, the image of the Dutch masters, kind of talking about this, you know, this sort of Europe of this sort of white European background. The image of the dying Gaul, which is an art reproduction image, such as might have been found at the museum for mm-hmm. educational purposes. I thought was an interesting reference again to natural selection.
Sure.
And to the idea of like this heroic ideal being felled.
You have the hat box from a fancy Park Avenue men's store.
Again, maybe a reference to class somehow. I mean, I think that perhaps the most interesting places in people's homes are not areas of display,
but
the bathrooms, the closets, the shops,
places.
The garages.
Exactly.
And so I wanted to fill this closet with objects of very personal use, a coat, a pair of suspenders, and a belt, and things that were stored away, in fact, kind of hidden, if you will, the images, more images of African heads.
And more of the charts from the survey and from the university that you got.
That's right.
Let's take a look at the information room, which is a separate component of the installation. And as we discussed, the effort in here was to really present a history of the eugenics survey, of the eugenics movement and the eugenics survey of Vermont, which was created with the help of Nancy Gallagher and Kevin Dayon. We've covered what we consider to be a number of the most important moments or components of the history of the eugenics survey. And we've begun with kind of an overview and a piece on Henry Perkins. And have also included artifacts from the university, from Special Collections, including the annual reports from the Eugenics Survey over a period of years. And in notebooks on the table, we've reproduced a large number of documents from the period, including Xeroxes of all of the survey reports.
I think that the information room also formally for me acts as a kind of breathing place.
Yeah, definitely.
So many people have commented on the claustrophobic nature of the room, the nightmarish quality of it, the density of all the information, that I think it's a place where you have to begin to, for yourself, confront some of the imagery that you've mm-hmm. seen with these facts.
Right, reconcile it with the facts of it.
Because I think it's, to many people it seems somewhat fantastic, and they can't understand how this actually happened.
That's right.
Here.
And then to come into this somewhat, you know, much more Spartan environment and sit down and begin to read some of the actual documents and realize, in fact, the atrocity of it, really the horror. Underneath the glass on the table are photocopies of articles that Perkins had cut out and put in a notebook, in his scrapbooks.
That's right.
And most of these deal with, actually follow the progress of the sterilization legislation. But it was also, it's quite telling to see what he cut out and
That's
how
right.
he presented them.
Well, I think that what emerges from my research with Perkins is the fastidious nature of his skills as a cataloger, as an administrator, as a person who is able to, I think maybe through sheer force of personality and will, create a lot of interest for this project,
yeah,
which
absolutely.
Again started out as a kind of perhaps more innocent kind of experiment, you know, with a few students, and what eventually snowballed into a little mini, corporate entity, if you will,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
the idea of an office with a secretary and with researchers and with extensive document storage, which really became, the Eugenics Survey was very influential, ultimately. It led to the enactment of these sterilization laws, or the passage of these sterilization laws. And I think that what's important to keep in mind is that very quickly something which became merely interesting took on the very significant proportions culturally
exactly.
and historically. And I think when we look at the greater context of eugenics worldwide and how eugenics to this day under various names is still practiced, I think, you know, it is quite shocking that that this did happen here.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that the information room really provides a very, as objective as possible, a kind of presentation in as short a space
right,
of time.
Exactly.
Because, you know, there are thousands of documents, there are thousands of reports, there are scores of books available in Nancy Gallagher's quite excellent bibliography on eugenics,
mm-hmm.
which one could go through in order to form a more personal opinion
mm-hmm.
of
exactly.
genetics, genetic eugenic history, and the history of the Eugenics Survey of Vermont. And it's important, I think, to go back and forth between the suggestions that Long Shadows kind of presents and then this information in here, because the last thing that I want to do is to create any complete untruths
mm-hmm,
about
mm-hmm.
about the survey. I think that I've had to rely on metaphor in order to make my point. And I think that's the difference between art and perhaps art and history.
That's
or maybe that's what's missing from history, is that we assume that history is completely objective. And history is always written by someone with a particular point
that's
of view.
Right. And this addresses that and acknowledges it.
Exactly. And art is always made from a particular yeah. point of view as well. And to kind of bring those two things together, might not create something which is objective, but for me it creates something which is personal and I believe fairly responsible.
Mm-hmm. And in the comment book, a number of students, this installation was heavily attended by students at the university in classes and on their own, and a number of students commented on the value of receiving history in this way Someone commented that they had studied the eugenics movement in class, but that this had made it so much more vivid. And I think it is a very valuable, you know, means of talking about history
That's right. You
know, through the eyes of contemporary artists.
Should we go to the table now and take a look at some of the comments and some of the material which we compiled?
One of the things that we debated early on was how much information to give in the installation about the objects that you're looking at. And we ultimately decided that it was a good idea to have a checklist of everything or most of the objects in the installation, but not to make it available in the installation itself.
That's right.
Thinking that people in museums tend to rely in a way on written information and descriptions and label copy. And
see first, ask questions later.
Or read first and think about it later.
True.
Whereas in this case, if they didn't have it in hand, you would have to really make the connections and think about the metaphors on your own. But we did want it available so that afterwards people could come back and if they had questions about objects, could check them. Then in the notebooks that we have provided on the tables, there are documents that relate to the subjects of the wall panels, such as the Vermont Commission on Country Life, the family studies in the Eugenics Survey, the actual methods by which they collected the data.
That's right.
Some background on intelligence testing and eugenics. In addition to, as I said, the contents of the annual reports. There are a couple of comments that were left in the book that I think might be interesting to address.
Mm-hmm.
One of the very few criticisms of the installation was that the victims or the subjects, the people whose lives were affected by the eugenics survey, did not have a voice in it. There was no focus on them. You came out of it with this feeling that something very terrible had happened, but you really didn't have a sense of the people to whom it had happened.
Well, I think it's a great criticism, and I think it's one which is at the heart of the difficulty in addressing both history and art simultaneously. And if I could, if I can make you think back to the chart that we saw, for instance, when I originally discovered the chart, I was almost sure that we were looking at a chart that was filled with pseudonyms,
mm-hmm.
because the Eugenics Survey had employed many pseudonyms for the various study groups. The Pirate family,
right.
The Korea family, people who suffered from Huntington's chorea, the Gypsy family, which most certainly described a group of people that had, as Perkins would say, an admixture of blood, of
mm-hmm.
Native American,
mm-hmm.
of Negro blood, of the blood of Jews,
mm-hmm.
and Roman Catholics, and other groups which were considered undesirable groups. And that chart, as it turns out, contains Christian names and surnames which are not falsified.
Right.
And if you remember, we had some discussion as to whether or not we should cover up those names,
yeah.
or whether they should be presented directly. I think in the end there were many visitors who were shocked and very interested to find their own family names on that chart,
mm-hmm.
and I'm glad that we revealed that.
Yeah.
But I did not go out of my way to present information on specific people because I felt that in some ways it was an invasion of privacy.
Mm-hmm.
It was not possible to contact all of these people. Many of them were dead. And the records themselves don't always indicate cultural background.
Mm-hmm.
They're very spotty, in fact. And so even though there are many people who recognize their own family names there and who know what their background is, be it Abnaki or be it a person of French-Canadian or Italian background or of Jewish ancestry, I decided to focus on Perkins as this kind of figurehead because I felt that what was done was significant enough to start this dialogue again.
Right.
And I think that certainly the most vocal group in terms of claiming a connection to the Eugenics Survey and who are who claimed to be most affected by it are the Abnaki. Mm-hmm. And I had the opportunity to meet a man of Abnaki ancestry who was sterilized under this law, and he was not interested in talking to me about what had happened to him. And I'm hoping as this airs that people might come forward who are willing to share some stories. Many of these people who were sterilized are no doubt deceased by now, but there might still be some people out there who have stories to tell, if not of their own experience directly, then the experiences of relatives.
And that's something that has happened in other states who had eugenics surveys. In the information on the table, there is an article from a publication in Virginia called Sterilization Survivors Speak Out that was oral histories of a number of people who had gone through that in Virginia.
That's right. Well, I think that the only way that this piece will transcend its formal and, you know, aesthetic qualities is if this information is somehow made useful.
Mm-hmm.
If it's integrated back into the culture. I'm hoping to repatriate the 12-foot-long chart as well as several other documents to either the university or the state of Vermont via the university. And I'm hoping that those objects won't just be locked away and sort of forgotten again for 60 more years. My hope is that that some dialogues will be created and to further address the criticism of people who say that this piece is kind of faceless in a way, in which it doesn't address victims.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'd like to clarify the project by saying, you know, it was my objective to create a work of art.
Exactly.
And it was also my objective to create a work of art with a kind of different social conscious than my works usually have. You know, I'm usually interested in my own kind of narratives, I'm kind of in love with the notion of discovery as a subject matter in and of itself. And I think that if this piece were to be moved elsewhere, or if it were to have another kind of life,
mm-hmm.
it would have to be fleshed out now by people who are willing to
bring
new information to the table,
right.
You know, which I might be able to do something with and which others might be able to do something with. But at any rate, I created what I felt was a complete piece.
Mm-hmm.
And even though it doesn't address every point of view, I think it creates the context for discussion, which was my objective.
Right. Let me ask you also about the role of narrative in this piece as opposed to earlier pieces. I mean, your installations have frequently dealt with historical events or historical figures, and there is some narrative that is implied or suggested or provided. In this one, it really had a stronger, you know, more insistent narrative, and I wonder what the challenges were of working with that.
That's pretty interesting. Part of the process that I go through is a kind of assessment of memory. My memories, cultural memories. There's a term that I like to use, which I'm using more frequently in the context of my work, which is this notion of cultural amnesia. And I think that I liken the process of creating a piece like this to this mnemonic device, which was employed thousands of years ago for remembering stories, which is that one creates a space in one's mind, a house. And in the house, there are rooms. And the rooms contain, if you will, a separate part of the story. And it is by moving through the house that one recalls the story. And while that translation isn't complete in terms of this piece, because we don't all share the same story, we don't all share the same house, if you will, in our heads, I'm trying to create a room which, in which the objects are imbued with certain kinds of memories. I think that you think of a certain period when you see a table from the 18th century, and you think of a certain period when you see a Baroque frame around a painting, and a black and white photograph is perhaps more evocative of a time period than is a color Polaroid. So it is by pairing text and objects, and by the positioning of those objects and text within the space, that I try to create that house in my head. Before I made this piece, I produced drawings. Before those drawings became directly implemented into the space. A model was created. Mm-hmm. And the model was used to get a sense of where things had to go. But it was in looking at the objects and in writing that the ideas of how one moves around the space conceptually, as opposed to physically, were really born. And I think that you know, my previous works, which have dealt ever increasingly as time goes on with historical subject matter, have been about finding a way to kind of present an alternative to the idea of the novel or of the documentary. And I think of kids working in school. You know, kids work on a project and they go and see a film and they read a book and then they interview somebody who had a particular experience, mm-hmm. and then they pick up objects which were used in some sort of context, let's say a Stone Age tool or an arrowhead or a butter churn or some, you know, other object which played a role in this particular story. And why is it that these things always manifest themselves ultimately in a paper, mm-hmm. in a book mm-hmm. report, as it were?
Right.
I think, you know, as an artist, I was interested in trying to create something which was interactive, not in the sense of the way we think of interactivity now, like a computer, but a space that you kind of physically move through. Not a virtual reality, mm-hmm. but a kind of hyper-reality.
So did you make many of your projects visual as a child in school?
I did. I think that I was interested in the same kinds of things that I'm interested in now. They're perhaps more sophisticated. Mm-hmm. I remember making little kits for, this is really a confession here, but little kits for my classmates that were about learning the various body parts of the grasshopper, something with an audio cassette and a transparency. And it was, in a way, a kind of miniature version of what I'm interested in now.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think that I've always been drawn to things which simultaneously can explain a great deal and yet, because of the imagery involved, are very mysterious. I mean, those transparencies of the human body that you can find in any encyclopedia tell you how the human body functions, mm-hmm. and where mm-hmm. things are located. But the idea of a human body cut in half with the organs revealed still functioning, mm-hmm. is completely mysterious and provocative. And I think that Long Shadows is kind of like a flaying of a mentality or a vivisection, if you will, of an ideology.
Yeah.
And some things you understand and some things you don't. And I don't claim to understand everything that's included in the piece. But it's everything is there for a kind of reason, be it metaphoric or to create a layer of mystery, mm-hmm. or something else.
Well, in concluding, let me ask you if you would look forward to working with other museum collections in the future. Is it something you would want to take on again?
I would. I mean, I think that there was an extraordinary situation here. For me, everything was right. I'm from this area. I was working with a curator whose work I respected. It was a collection that I was familiar with from the time that I was a child. I don't know that all those conditions are going mm-hmm. to be there next time. I doubt that they will be. And I do have several invitations to work with some collections. I imagine I'll be working with them in a very different way. One of the nice things about working with the Fleming's collection is that it, while it contained a lot of objects, it is a small museum. And it's, I think, a place that could be flexible enough in terms of its priorities. I guess the opportunity to work with this huge collection of objects really got the creative juices flowing, and it made me think about the possibilities inherent with things that were already made. I've long been a fan of the found object, but this is kind of like the refound object.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I think that the situation here at the Fleming was an ideal one. And hopefully with other museum collections, I'll have as flexible a group of people and ideas to work with.
Mm-hmm.
From a witness of policemen come a witness of tale, about a feeble-minded family in a witness of jail. Lunatics are morons, no one knows. 15 people taken off a monument road. Too little, maybe, well, and falling down. Well-known terror of a witness of town. Abernacle gypsy, so it goes. 15 people taken off a Monument Road. The most of them live
where the pins are the thickest.
The most of them live
where the pins are the thickest.
The most of them live
where the pins are the thickest.
The most of them live
where the pins are the thickest.
The most of them live
where the pins are the thickest.
The most of them live
where the pins are the thickest.
The most of them live
where the pins are the thickest.
The most of them live. Sells a maidenhead and stinks of gin. Devil, he's a father, what don't look like him? Lunatics or morons, no one knows. 15 people taken off.